Hello, this is Nick Vanderwall, and this is another Rambling Illustrator webinar. If you're watching this on YouTube, this is a live session that we do every other week. And we've got some fantastic friends of Astute Graphics who've joined us online here, and also some new faces as well, so that's fantastic. This webinar is going to be about lines, and predominantly about one plugin called WidthScribe. It's a plugin I've neglected for years, and it's actually one of my favorite plugins. I've really hinted at this in several recent webinars. I really should come back and visit it again, but I thought I'm not going to do a classic WidthScribe one. I wanted to do something new. The only trouble is that when I do something new, it's usually completely and utterly experimental. And I did have to admit, I'm trying not to rehearse these ones, these rambling ones, but I did actually have a little go with this for the past little bit of time, and I managed to crash Illustrator. I don't know if anybody's ever done that before, crash Illustrator. It's a very hard thing to crash. And I found out it wasn't our plugins. I did stress Illustrator a bit too much in its variable stroke width tool. So it's going to be fun, and it's going to be about WidthScribe and about sketching as well. So we're going to use some other plugins as well. So let's go for this. It's a bit different, and it's also going to rely on me sketching something, which is, I haven't really got much talent in that direction. So before I start, I'm going to set my user interface up a bit more. First of all, I want something called the width stamp panel here. This is part of WidthScribe. If you haven't got the width stamp panel open, obviously you have to install the plugins first. Go down the window menu, and you can find WidthScribe down here, and there are three associated panels with it. And I wanted the width stamp panel, which is open here. So great, I've got that one open. I'm also going to be using Dynamic Sketch. Now, Dynamic Sketch, I've got it here. And if you haven't got it open, window menu, go down to Dynamic Sketch, and you can find the Dynamic Sketch panel there. So these are two panels I'm going to be making use of. I'm going to really minimize the other panels. I want a bit more screen space. Oh, I forget, there's one more panel I'm going to use, and that is texturing, but I'm not going to use it continuously. I'm only going to use it at the start. So here's my texturino panel. And again, that can be found down in the window menu, texturino and texture panel here. Great. I'm going to move these a little bit to one side at the moment. In fact, I can lock these together at the moment. Okay. What I'm going to do, I'm going to show a new experimental way that I've been trying to develop for sketching in Illustrator. And it's not groundbreaking, but hopefully it makes you think, oh, hang on, these tools have got something in them. I can experiment with this. So I'm going to start by drawing a simple rectangle. I'm going to use the simplest native tool in Illustrator, just draw a rectangle. And within that, I'm going to make sure it's got no stroke and just a white fill, so you can see it. Well, that's complex. And in the texture panel here, which is part of Texturino, I'm going to add a texture to it. So I'm just going to click on the plus symbol, like that. And I just went for literally the first texture that is literally opening. Actually, I don't really want the texture for its normal purposes. I'll get onto that. And I'm going to move this texture around because I think this is a landscape texture, and I want it to be portrait because my drawing space is portrait. And I'm going to scale it down. And you can see if I scale it down too far, you can see the sort of bounding box of the texture. And I wanted it a bit more high resolution, a bit more detail on this texture. Perfect. Like I said, I'm not really that bothered about what texture I'm using, which sounds really, really weird, doesn't it? Okay, let's go to the line tool. And I'm just going to draw a line on this artboard here. I'm going to go to the select tool and give it a black stroke. And if I increase the width of that stroke or the weight of that stroke, you can see there's a simple line. So I'm going to select both of these now. And I'm going to put texturing away for a while. I'm going to get Dynamic Sketch and put it down there and put these two panels over to this side. And I'm going to look at this width stamp panel, because if you haven't used width stamp before, basically you don't make banknotes. That's one way of putting it. Another way of putting it is you have an experiment with something which is really very, very interesting. Because if I have, say, just a line, and this is a very simple line, and this texture in the background, I make sure the texture, or the thing I want to base this line width on, as we'll see, is in the background, the line's on top. I can click on Make with Top Object, and you get this result. Now, what is this result? It's a bit of a strange thing, isn't it, to do this? Well, let's look at this. Let's actually zoom in a bit. What's happened is that this line is actually based on the color variations or the contrast variations. Sorry, so I didn't really care about the color. The contrast variations of the underlying image. Now that underlying image could actually be vector, but in this case I wanted a bitmap texture with lots and lots of variation because I wanted a stroke here or a line which has got lots going on. Now let's zoom out again a little bit. And let's look why I've gone to all this bother to do this. Now if I select this object here, basically I've selected this, it isn't a live effect, this width stamp one. It's it's a special art type that's in Illustrator. And I can either edit the underlying image or select the underlying image or edit the source art as it's called here in the panel. Or I can edit the contours, which is the line on top. And you see, if I clicked over to this contours one, I can suddenly access this line. Okay, again, not exactly that interesting in its own way. But what happens if I were to double click on this and enter this isolation mode? So I'm actually within this group of lines at the moment, and there's only one at the moment. But say I were to add another. Look what happens here. Basically, everything I draw suddenly has these width variations going on it. Now, again, it's a bit of a contrived thing at the moment. So let's look why I want to do this. What I want to do is sketch in Illustrator. Now, you think that Illustrator is all about illustration, about sketching. It isn't. Illustrator is a terrible package normally at sketching. It's all too geometric. It's all too stiff, shall we say. So I wanted to sketch, and I wanted it to be a bit more natural with the variations that you get when drawing on paper or any other sort of medium. I wanted little variations. Now, obviously what I've got here is a disastrous amount of variation for sketching. No pen ever really sketches like that. If it does, take the pen back to the shop. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to look at the width stamp panel, and I'm going to take down the fidelity on purpose of this result. And you can see that it's changing. Now I'm going to also use these options. I'm going to use tapering. I'm going to taper at the end. In fact, I'm going to make the taper smaller. I'm going to make a 1 millimeter taper at the end of each stroke. And then I'm going to look at the graph. I'm going to go, well, there's still a bit too much variation going on. So let me use a graph to perhaps take some of the extremities off that variation. And now, hopefully it's coming through in the webinar screencast type thing. And it will come through on the YouTube recording, I hope. Is that there are variations to this stroke which are very natural, and they're all based on that rather random image that's in the background. So what can I do now? Well, I can actually start sketching this. But before I do, I did say at the start of this that I did manage to crash Illustrator because we are going to be using the variable width technology, the native one in Illustrator, rather a lot. And when I made it crash, the variable width report went, I couldn't cope anymore. So we are going to stress test it. So before we forget, I'm going to go to autosaver, and I'm going to make sure that's open. I'm going to go to file, and I'll do save as, and I'm going to save it to my desktop, and I'm going to call it, let's just call it sketch. Let's just keep it really easy there and do it like that. Okay, great. So I've saved my sketch to the desktop. And now I'm going to rely on autosaver to keep on saving for me every 5 minutes. I'm doing this because I am stressing out Illustrator. This is a bit of an experimental thing as well. And I'd like to hear the feedback while we're going along, whether this is actually useful or actually interesting to anybody. So it may be something that just sparks interest, or maybe something that people are going to try. So again, I'm in the sketch now. So anywhere within this white rectangle, which is the artboard and the size of the rectangle, the texture, I can sketch and it will create lines with these variations on it. So let's have a go with this. Again, I'm going to double click on it to dive into it. I'm going to delete that tool and delete that tool. Move this one to one side. I want to keep one line just for the moment. And now I'm going to reach for my Wacom, which is the next daring thing, because Wacoms and webinars are notoriously bad friends. They do like, the Wacom drivers do like to have their moments at times. So I'm going to go to the dynamic sketch tool, and the dynamic sketch tool is under the shaper tool and is at the bottom here. I already had it selected there. And I'm going to draw a circle in dynamic sketch. Now remember, I am zoomed in a bit. Look at that circle. That is because, and suddenly it goes back down. I'll explain that. You can see that that circle, I went round a few times, has joined itself together in Dynamic Sketch, which is quite interesting in its own right. In fact, if it is dynamic, I could make that circle more or less compliant with the original sketch lines that I had. That's another webinar in its own right. Now let's go out. Let's say, why were those annotations when I was sketching so chunky like that? Well, let's just go out of here a second and select this whole object. And I'm going to go back to here. And you can see the underlying image has actually moved, which is a bit annoying. We'll get back to that. And let's look at these. In fact, go back into here. And I'm going to select everything. I'm going to go to the stroke panel. And I can see that I set the weight at 50 points just so I could show you where that line was, the original line was. Well, let's take it back down to, say, 2 points. Okay, and you notice nothing's actually changed on the artboard. That is because the actual sketch width is defined by the width stamp tool, not by the stroke weight here anymore. But the width was sort of defining in Dynamic Sketch how big that annotation should be. And now you can see it's gone much smaller. So that's why it was larger. So let's go into Dynamic Sketch again and actually start to experiment with this. Firstly, I'm going to get this circle or ellipse I made. And then I'm going to delete the other things. I'm going to sketch out a plant pot with a flower in it. I'm going to get rid of the smart guides. I don't want anything. I want it to be quite a natural sketch. I'm going to also make it a bit thinner, the lines. All the lines I'm going to draw are going to be the same width. I can't vary the widths. It's not taking the input from the Wacom pen. It isn't like that. I want it to be almost like a biro on rough paper, where it's varying subtly all the time. So you can see if I change this, it's all live. It's actually not changing the line itself, so to speak. It's just changing the effect on top of it. Same with the taping. I could knock them off, etc. I can turn these things on off. I could put smoothing on it. It's all live. Again, I can put fidelity up and you see it all changes. So let's go again back to Dynamic Sketch. Now I've got a key press letter K for Dynamic Sketch. In my case, I've set up with the keyboard preferences, or you select in the toolbar like that. Now let's look in the Dynamic Sketch panel on the preferences to see what would make it better for sketching. First of all, if I sketch like this, you have the sketching or the dynamic sketch annotations, these little S's. Let me draw another one here. And you can see a little S appears here. We'll draw one here. You've got an S appearing here. I don't necessarily want those. So let me go into the Dynamic Sketch preferences. And I'm in the tool already. I'm going to hit the Enter key. And I'm going to go down to the bottom bit here. I know there are lots of preferences. Don't panic. If you go completely wrong, just go to the flat menu, go to default again if you go completely wrong. But in this case, I want to get rid of the Dynamic Sketch path indicators, those little S's. I also want to probably get rid of the width stroke here. But I'll tell you, I'll leave it for the moment because it makes it a bit thicker for the webinar so you can see it. So I'll leave that. But if I was drawing off the webinar, I wouldn't have that. So I'll have that and click on OK. And suddenly those S's have gone. But I've still got the actual Bezier points in this path. I don't really want that when I'm sketching. So again, go to View menu, Hide Edges. So these are all selected, but you can't really see them. So let's have a go now. And you can see how I can start sketching without hindrance. Now, another thing that's quite important is that if I go to Illustrator's Preferences, which is Command-K on the Mac, if I am going to use it as quick as possible, actually, in this case, I would like to have GPU performance enabled. It actually makes quite a noticeable difference when you're sketching. It genuinely does. So I've got that enabled. I've also got this relatively, it's not a beta, but they're still a little bit concerned because it isn't ticked by default. This real-time drawing and editing on. Okay, let's leave that on. But with all that enabled, let's see what I can do with this thing and how I can sketch. Now, remember, I am rubbish at sketching. So I'm going to make a plant pot. Okay, so I've got the Wacom next to me. In Dynamic Sketch, I have none for pressure. The pressure isn't going to be of any use anyway in this one. I've got a lot of smoothing going on, middle accuracy, and not much string length. String length is quite good. It sort of smooths things out a bit. Okay, so let me go. And I'm going to make repeated strokes on here, because I want to sketch. In fact, I'll leave things in which are a mistake. That's how I sort of sketch in real life. So let's draw the bottom of this vase here. And It's a real sort of rough sketch. I do want something extremely rough. I don't want to start to get too accurate with this at all, as you can see. And you hopefully can also see this is going actually quite quickly. It's not slowing down too much, this whole thing, which is quite a nice thing to actually see in Illustrator. It's quite an intuitive thing. Now, lots of sketch strokes are starting to appear on this artboard, and it is all with variable stroke width. This is stressing out Illustrator, I'll guarantee, in the background. Okay, that's why I've got the auto saver on. In fact, all these individual sketches are a bit cumbersome like that. Now, why don't I use, say, the blob brush tool? Okay, here's a reason. So, I'm going to draw the stalk here of the plant, and I'm going to make it just a bit darker here with the repeated ones. And I'm going to get a leaf going off. Now, say this part here I don't like. No, I'll keep the original one, but I've got a line which is going off very much at tangent. I don't want that. You know what I've done? I have just turned over my Wacom stylus, which has got that eraser bit on the end. I'm in Dynamic Sketch. That's neat. Let's get rid of it. Turn the stylus over again. This is actually, I keep on pressing the middle button on the stylus as well. That's annoying. This is actually very natural sketching. It's really, really good. So if I were to draw a leaf here like this. Now, I'll explain why it's gone quite thin on the end there, because the underlying image has actually moved. I noticed this earlier. So we'll come back to that. So let's have a look. So you can see where it's starting to go. I don't like what's happening here, but anyway, my sketching ability, that's it. But let's go out of that isolation mode, because I was in the isolation mode to edit there. And I'll go back to editing the image. And you can see the image has moved. I mean, that really is a little bit annoying. And if I get the hold of that, it's really actually quite annoying. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to move the, it's because I can't see the edges. Show edges like that. And then you can see, oh, do you see autosave? It just flashed up very, very quickly there. It's saving my bacon in case anything horrible goes wrong. Okay, and now I've done that, I can go back into the editing of the lines, and I'll put it back in here. Anyway, I think it's moved the whole thing in, hasn't it? Let me just see what's happened here. Let me go back to this mode. Yes, it's moved the whole thing, which is really annoying. Okay, I'm going to cheat. I'm going to move it like that. Da la 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 la. There we go. Ha! I knew I'd get it. So, I've moved that texture back into where it should be in the background. So, we've got that going on. Now, again, if I don't like, if it's too thick or something like that, let's zoom in and let's take the level down a bit. And I can see that you've got the variation. Now, again, I might want a bit more variation in the overall, let me just get selected, that always helps, in the overall lines that I'm drawing here. So, let's again look how dynamic this is. Again, I'm going to increase the fidelity a bit too much. It's a bit like one of those Quinton Blake illustrations in the UK. He does those fantastic Roald Dahl ones, where if you get it too much, he does it on purpose. Very, very sketchy sort of thing. I love his stuff. So you can see how I can vary that. Now, I'm not varying the actual width with the stylus. All I'm doing, I'm looking at the overall lines itself and the placement of the line. So I've gone back to Dynamic Sketch. I'm going to delete a whole load of things here. And let me just go back here, select some things here, delete those. I don't like those. In fact, let me just, because they're individual, this is why I'm not using the, that's a bit too much deletion, I think. This is why I'm not using the blob brush tool. Things are merged and they're not really dynamic. If I do want to get rid of certain lines like this, I can. Now, I intentionally wanted to keep it rather sketchy, so I'm not going to go too far, but I just want to demonstrate you can go back like that. And also, you notice I've not got that repeat sketching on in Dynamic Sketch, which would have modified the original line if I keep on tracing over the top of it. Again, that's perhaps for another occasion, that one. I wanted to really keep it very, very, very crude on purpose, and also because I can't draw. So, all good creatives say everybody can draw. All they need to do is keep drawing. I've been doing it for how many years? Still can't draw. Anyway, whatever. So, you get the idea of where it's going to. But, what I want to do now... That is a terrible design, isn't it? You should never say that. As a trainer, you should... Oh, that's a bit better. As a trainer, you should never say you're terrible about something. That's one of the number one things you should never say. Anyway, there you go. I'm a terrible designer. I can use Illustrator, but there you go. So, again, please, in the chat session, please have a look at, you know, what is going on here. Give us some feedback. I'm trying to look at the comments that are coming in as well. So, please give it. I'm just reading the comments at the same time. This is quite a hard thing to do. There we go. So, is that bucket handle? Thank you very much. I'm getting abusive comments with regards to my sketching ability. Okay, but what I wanted to do is, more seriously, look at the tool itself and think, well, okay, now I've done this, how do I go and really modify the widths of this actual artwork? Because, again, I want to use WidthScribe here. Myra says on the thing, I see an alien. Myra, I'm not a doctor. Okay, so what I'm going to do is go out of here, select this width stamp here that I've got here, and I'm going to expand it. Now, if I expand it, that doesn't mean it becomes expanded strokes in its own right. These remain as individual paths that are editable. In fact, it's all grouped. Let me ungroup it. Ungroup it again. And you can see these are individual paths still, but they've got the variable stroke width on it. So what do I want to do here, in fact, let me get rid of the rest of that one. What I wanted to do here to actually make some areas more bold or less bold, I'm going to use another tool in WidthScribe. Okay, so let me get rid of Dynamic Sketch for a moment, or reduce it down. Actually, I'm going to park it back up here. And I leave the Width Stamp tool, well, I'll reduce that down as well. I'm going to look at the toolbar, and I'm going to look at this tool called the Width Brush tool. The Width Brush tool allows me to brush in widths. This is a fantastic, fantastic thing. I'm going to hide the edges again. And with the width brush tool selected, I'm going to hit the enter key. And you can see here are some controls for it. There are obviously key press shortcuts as well, which I can obviously bring open here and go to Astute Buddy panel. Right. And if I use it, autosave is going again. It's lovely. And I can make certain areas thicker. So for example, I'm going to make the brush smaller, the effective brush of the width thing, by holding the left square bracket key. And now I'm going to brush on some extra widths on this side. So let's do that here. And I want to just have it going under here, under the sort of pot rim, a bit darker like that. Perhaps on the back end of the pot here as well. I'm brushing on the widths of this. It's a very, very unique thing. If I want to go the opposite way around, from memory. That's a width erase. I don't want to do that. Well, the erasing tool. What I want to do is perhaps, let me see. I'm going to, reverse adjustment. Hold down the shift key, and I make certain lines thinner. So I can make certain lines thinner, and can make certain lines thicker, and these are the portions of the lines. And again, this is just working with the variable stroke width technology native in Illustrator. Okay, let's do that. So, I can just reduce because I'm not using the Astute Buddy at the moment anyway. Let me just thicken it here. Again, depends a bit on the pressure you apply. So I could make it much thicker on this side here, like that. And I can make it much thinner by holding down the shift key, and you can reverse it out again. So that's the overall order. That's a concept I had for sketching with these sort of variations to make it much more interesting as an Illustrator program to sketch in. How do you make Illustrator actually a bit more interesting, a bit like an iPad sort of program to sketch in? But the advantage of, you see, is you keep everything completely and utterly dynamic here. So I can get the width in, I can take them out, etc., like that. The other thing is that if you really, really, really don't want to have variable stroke widths on this anymore, remember, if I go to the outline mode, these are all the original sketches or sketch strokes. I'll go back to the GPU mode. If I want to just remove all that variance of lines that's going on here, in the native tool, you can't really do it. You have to select one at a time and then go. You can see all the variants in the stroke widths here. And then you go here and then click uniform. And you'd have to individual. Because if I selected them all, they're all different. And you Oh, you can now. They've changed it. I'll take it back. Latest version of Illustrator, they've changed it. You can actually... Let me do that again. Yes, you can. I'll take it back. They've got a way now to do it all uniform. That's the nice thing about the Rambling thing. I'm discovering things as well. Dope. So I could actually change it then all in one go to a sort of sketch thing like that. So again, you can see what you're doing with your variable stroke widths on this. So I hope that that part of the demonstration is something of interest. It's just something I wanted to explain with. It's an idea of how to play differently in Illustrator. And I always want people to think about how can you use tool X, Y, or Z to work differently. So please have a look at that. So give us some comments on that. Because I wanted to show also what traditionally the width stamp tool is used for. So let me quickly do that before I go on to another section, go on to the Q&A section. So please put your questions or your comments in as I'm going along here, and I'll come back to that. So let me create a new document here, and this time I'm going to go to A4, and I'll go landscape, and I will create a document here, and I'm going to start dragging a file into it. Now, we have a file that we used this morning. I love this file. Here we go. I love this. We actually use this on, it's an Adobe stock image, and we use it on an email today. Some people say, does it look aggressive? I hope not, but it's just a funny image, I find. So we've got that, and I'm going to embed that image. It's actually a very, very high resolution image. You can see, for example, all the detail in the beard there. So this is a great thing. So I'm going to hide the artboards. I hate the artboards. We're in view. And now what I'm going to do is go to the width stamp tool again, and I'm going to show really what people tend to use it for. And in the width stamp tool, I'm going to go to the flyout menu, and I'm going to go to default settings. And now I'm going to make with a preset. In fact, let me just make sure it's okay. Yeah, I'm going to go show curve here. For some reason, I didn't have this curve showing. So if you go to the flyout menu here, you can show or hide the curve here. I want you to show the curve. And I want to make a preset. You can see the presets down here before apply. I want to go for waves. And then, okay, I'm going to make a wave preset. You'll see what I mean. It's just saved again, hasn't it? And I'm going to do make with presets here. Now, this is obviously a very, very dark image at the moment. So let me just take it down. Let me take the maximum. Whoa, my eyes have just gone. Right. Let me take the maximum down to like that. In fact, I'm going to take it down even further like that. And now I'm going to take the angle off these waves, and I'm going to make them horizontal. This is interesting. This looks like a rendering issue in... Oh, that's interesting. There's a rendering issue going on in the variable stroke width technology. That I haven't seen before. Let me go back to 45 degrees. They do mess around with it a little bit, and that is not a good thing, actually. So that's an interesting... Because these are all variable, native variable stroke widths in the background here. And it's something I've never seen before. So let me take it down to here. Do that to the end. You can see these defects. We're going to have to report that to Adobe. I haven't seen that. So that's going to be an interesting one to report. Perhaps it's the waves. Let's change it to grid. There we go. Let's do that again. I'm interested to see if we can replicate that all the time. No, it seems to be the waves that have made it go a bit doolally. You can see all the different presets we've got going with it. That's a funny one. Zigzags. No, I wanted waves. I still want waves. And if I change it 10 degrees, it's interesting. Anyway, so let's have a look at that 45 degrees. And what we're going to do, we're going to increase it here. And then going down here, we can decrease the spacing between it, and you can start to see what's going on. Now, this curve is great for basically adjusting the tone or the tonality in the image. And when I said at the start, if you haven't used Width Scribe, then you haven't made a banknote before. Hopefully that becomes a little bit clearer now. Let me see. Let me change the amplitude of that. And you can see how that image is actually being made completely with vectors now, these vector stroke widths. And if I zoom in, you can see how they are absolutely perfectly sharp. So I can do it that way. Obviously, I can change all the amplitude down here. I can use dashes, which is one thing I always love doing. So basically, when the tone gets very light, you can use dashes to, let me just a little bit more so it's even more so. Actually, take this one out. Let's see what happens here. No, I need to take it down again. I'm trying to force these dashes to come back here. And you can see these dashes are creating the effect of a lighter tone. It's almost like doing stipples or a half tone in lighter shades. In this case, it isn't a great result. I haven't done a fantastic thing off the curves going on here. But hopefully you can see how it's going on. If I made, for example, the spacing even more, that's going to make it think. That's something I shouldn't have done. Make it go down to that level. That's a bit extreme. Let's do it to 0.5. So there's a lot of lines going on here, and there's a massive image of the background. Boy, if you want to make Illustrator pop its clogs, this is the one. Let's take it to 1. So again, you can start to see it. It's actually the anti-aliasing, the rendering doesn't start helping at that level, but you can start to see how those dashes are starting to interact now. So let's take the spacing back up again before I make Illustrator explode. So this is where you see a lot of our customers use this for security printing, for effects, general effects, etc. So so somebody has just asked, what was that phrase? Pop its clocks, somebody asked, Myra. No, pop its clogs. Pop it, oh, doesn't matter, let's move on. Popping its, no, just a British thing. Okay, that's a Dutch thing as well. So that is the overall idea of width stamp, but width stamp can do much more. If I release it again, what I can do is start, I love that picture, I really love that picture. I'm gonna lock it. I've got the L key to quickly go to the subscribe lock tool. I'm gonna lock that image, okay. Let's get out of there. And I'm going to make something in, I don't know, I might use the blend tool here. So let me just get rid of the Wacom tablet because I can't use a Wacom tablet for drawing normal stuff. And I'm going to draw an ellipse. Let me see, I will draw an ellipse like this. And then I'm going to use the offset tool. What the heck am I thinking? I'm going to use offset tool, of course. And I'm going to offset it with 200 steps. By the way, new stylism update today. If you haven't seen it, go to the Astute Manager, update your stylism. Brilliant things on both the offset tool and the block shadow tool. One of the things is that there's a way to force a color now, but I don't want it at the moment. So I want 200 steps and I want it to be like that. And I do want to force a stroke, actually. Force a stroke color of black. And I want to remove the fill color. There you go. There you go, that's an offset ellipse. Should I do it a bit more interesting? Should I make something, an offset something else? Let's go to the dynamic shapes tool. An offset what? An offset cloud? Yeah, no. Offsets at the top. Well, let's go more down. Offset, no, let's go for an offset heart, perhaps. Let's go for a basic heart. So, basic shape, there we go. An offset, yeah, this person screams love and affection. So, an offset heart is very, very suitable here. So, I'm going to get this, and I'm going to, I'll leave it. Expand appearance, like that. And I'll keep it as a group. And I'll put it over the top of heart. No, I won't put it on his nose. That's nasty. I'll select the two objects like this. And going back to the width stamp. Let's see. Let me just ungroup this top one. Like that. Path. Ungroup it together. Ungroup, keep it ungrouped, sorry. Make with top object. And let's see what happens. Oh, hang on. What am I doing? Mix objects. Let me just ungroup that here. So I make it a compound path. Add them all together. That's better. And then, there we go. It's all one compound path. Select it all. Oh, I've locked the underlined thing. I'm an idiot. I was thinking, why is it not taken? I've locked this image. That really doesn't help. Okay. Over his heart. Actually, Myra said over his heart. Myra's on form today. Select everything. Make a top object. Thank you. Over his heart. That's a great one. And you can see that my custom paths have now been the definition of where those lines are the basis of the variable stroke widths going on like that. So It is a fantastic thing. I could have actually kept that layer. I didn't actually need to expand it, perhaps. You know, perhaps it did. So you can see how it's so flexible, how you can make your own custom artwork or line tones with this line cut type styles, etc. So again, it's a bit of a random one. I just wanted to show something quite different. So I don't know if people were expecting this one today, but I wanted people to explore width scribe again. It's just one of those tools. I haven't even got onto the width gradient tool or the width selector tool, which actually to me is the most useful one, the whole lot. That way you can refine width markers, etc. But I just wanted to give you something to think about there. So that was that part of the demonstration. The next part I'm going to go on to is something completely different. But in the meantime, please, if you're online, obviously now, put your comments on. If you're watching this on YouTube, come online in the future and we'll be able to take your questions live and give you feedback live. So if you've got any questions about what you've just seen, you could ask live and then we can answer it a bit later. In the meantime, it's time, I think, for something a bit different. So we have the text up one again. Thank God for the mute button. Alan, that is so disrespectful. Oh, that's absolute. If it doesn't make you feel worse if I say that's my wife and child doing that. We did it as a joke and it stuck. I'm seriously not going to stop doing it until somebody pays me. Right, okay, so we have got a text talk. Now this is a suggestion from, well, let me say, it's a cheat. No, it's not a cheat. It's actually, after the last Rambling webinar, fantastic colleague, John, he said, you know what? How would you recreate this? And I said, easy. And then I thought, no, actually, it'll be a cheat. Actually, he asked how I would recreate it in the next Rambling webinar. Not how would he create it. Does he have a nuclear bunker at the back of his room? No. How we can recreate it in the webinar. And I do have several ideas in my head. And you know what? I didn't want to practice them before I went live. The reason being is that there were several ways. And I want to experiment like people experiment in reality. That's part of the reason of this whole Rambling webinar. So I'm going to embed it, this image, and I'm going to lock it. Okay. In fact, what I could do even better, let me make that a background layer here. Okay, so I'll go into the background, go into the layers panel. Make it background. I'm going to double click. I didn't even need to lock it, did I? Double click on it, and I'm going to say it's a template, and I'll dim it down to say 30%. Okay, like that. And I'm going to create a new layer to draw on. So let's have a look. The simplest thing on earth is in my mind how to recreate the nuclear one, the biohazard one on the right hand side. I've got some ideas. I'm going to have a play with it. So have a think yourself. How would you do it? Before you start on something like this, how would you do it? Now, obviously, I'm going to use Astute Graphics tools. I use them because I know them inside out, relatively. But first thing I'm going to do is get rid of smart guides. So if I go to view, I'm going to disable smart guides there. And then I'm going to go to the dynamic shapes tool. So let's pull out this panel a bit. And I'm going to go down to my dynamic shapes panel. Enable it. If you haven't got the dynamic shapes panel there it is. And let's start on this. First thing I suppose you would do is create guides normally, wouldn't you? Well, I can't be bothered. I think there's an easy way to, I can guess this. I'm in the dynamic shapes tool now, and I'm going to draw a basic circle. Now, two ways to make a basic shape is that I can click on this and it resets all the settings, or I can hit the letter B as I'm drawing things out. In fact, it's better to have the Astute Buddy panel open again. And I will keep that Astute Buddy panel there. Right, I'm going to draw now a basic circle. I'm going to start in the center. Now, if yours doesn't start in the center, once you've got the mouse held down, hit the S key, and it starts either from the 9-block position, and you can see the 9-block positioning in the panel here, or if you hit the S key, it starts in the center. I'm going to start from the center. And if it's not exactly right, I can hold the space bar down, move it until it's exactly over there. That's nice. That's why I didn't bother with guides. Hold down the shift key, constrain it to the middle. You know what I'm going to do next? I am going to make it a 6-pointed circle. You can't really do this in Illustrator natively, obviously. Can you use the left or right bracket keys if the dynamic shape is selected in your dynamic shapes tool. Or I can go into the panel and choose segments there. Now, I chose that because if I change it by 30 degrees, you can see how these things are now lining up. It's more because I just wanted to be a smart aleck doing that. I'm going to copy that, paste it in front. And I'm going to make it bigger, this copy, like that. Click on the dynamic shapes panel again to reactivate again. Change this outer dynamic shape into a donut. Click and hold on this point, not moving the mouse. Then hold the command key down before dragging, and you can alter the aspect ratio effectively of the donut. So you can do it like that. Now, two ways of doing it from here on onwards. In fact, there are many ways of doing this from here on onwards. The one I'm going to do is copy this to the pasteboard first. Get hold of this slice, and that's why I had these points. It's going to snap to this point. And it's the wrong way around. Hold down, let me get this right. If I adjust the slice by, I think it is, this one. Holding down, yes, good guess. Holding down the option key, this is a shortcut and a half. Holding down the option key and clicking on this slice icon reverses the slice. You can also do it by the flyout menu, reverse slice it there. But I remember there was something, reverse slice. Paste that one in front again. So I remember I copied it beforehand. Take this slice around here. Obviously, you can reverse the slice also by just dragging the handles around. Paste it in front again. Drag this handle out here. Drag this handle out here. I keep going the wrong way around the slices. And there you go. So there is my nuclear radar. Obviously, on this one, I'll make a compound path. You know, swap the fill and stroke. There you go. That's one way. So how would you have done it? Okay, that was too easy, John. This one's going to be a little tougher, isn't it? That's why he gave it to me, I'm sure. I think John wanted to test me. See if I was paying attention over the years on how to make things. Okay, I'm going to lock that layer off the nucleus symbol. I don't want to sort of be concerned with that one. I'll start a new layer. You know what? This one really, to me, looks like a Mirror Me job. So I'm going to get out Mirror Me. And I'm going to use dynamic shapes as well. There's going to be two things I'm going to use here. And let me get Mirror Me out here. I'm going to reduce down this panel so I've got a bit more breathing space with panels. The screen size is a little bit smaller because I'm ready on screen flow here. So I've got that one there. I'm going to do Command R to bring up the rulers. And I'm going to do rulers this time. And I'm going to make the center here. And hopefully I'm going to get this right. The center, I'm looking at the anti-aliased pixels, which is never great for the center of a circle, but anyway. It is now going to be, put it this way, that is now going to be the center of the shape, like that. If I go to Direct Prefs, down here, again, Window, Direct Prefs, you can get it open here. I can make sure I have locked the guides very quickly. I can unlock or lock it, hide or unhide. Very quick access to the guides. Okay, I've locked the guides. I'm now going to go to Dynamic Shapes again, and I'm going to draw a circle. Oh, I need Smart Guides now. Command U, Smart Guides. And I'm going to draw a circle, a basic one. I hit the B where I was drawing things out, and I'm going to draw it like that. Okay, that looks about right. Swap the fill and stroke. That is my starting point. But what I'm going to do next is actually draw a Mirror Me axis. So I'm going to go to number of axes, one, cool. I'm going to go to the Mirror Me tool, butterfly icon. If you're, by the way, if you're a company that wants to draw or make a mirroring tool in a future application, a butterfly icon is a fantastic symbol that you can use. Please use it freely. It's a fantastic one. Go for it. Right, I'm going to use a constrain angle, hold down the shift key and constrain the angle. I'm going to apply it to layer persistent, and then I'm going to increase the number of axes like that to 3 axes. I could have done that before, but I'm doing that after. I'm showing I can. So this is the drawing segment here. You can see if I darken off the other segments, it's to clearer. So I'm going to draw in this segment up here. So let me start by drawing a circle, and I'm going to draw the circle up here. Hold down the shift key, I want it vertical. And I'm going to draw it there. It's not quite in the right place. So you see, because it's moving, this is a cheat. Right, this is actually genuinely on the fly. I'm going to think about how I'm doing this now. So I'm going to make it a little bit larger. I'm a bit finickety. There we go. That's good. What else am I going to draw? I'm going to draw another circle going from the center. In fact, no, I'm going to draw a donut for this shape in the middle. Let me draw that donut a bit like before, like I did on the other one. I've made it a donut. Why don't I see a donut? Because it is a donut. Oh, because it's shape recognized. Okay. Let me just draw a donut here. And draw it in there. I didn't do that right. Oh, hang on. Let me, if dynamic shapes gets interfered with by Mirror Me, and it can happen, untick active for a moment. Then turn it into a donut like that. And the inner and outer donut, do you notice here, the inner and outer donut size are exactly the same. So if I did that, in fact, it locks it. If I did that, you can see the different sizes anyway. This is all experimentation, folks. Draw like that. So that's my inner donut there. I'm going to copy this and paste it and make it smaller. I could use dynamic shapes to reduce the size, but I'm going to just do it this way. Excellent. I'm going to go to dynamic sketch, K for me. And hold down the shift key, remove, 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 remove. Shift key, it becomes that slicing tool. Bit of fun there. I'm going to get, oh, hang on. Okay, let me see. I've got it active, haven't I? So if I release a compound path here, remove that, remove that, remove that, remove that. And now activate that mirroring again. And you can see how it's all gone on there. Next thing, I suppose, is the larger circle in the background, and then we've got little cuttings, haven't we? So, circle, it isn't at the same axis, it's around here. It's a bit of a strange drawing, actually, isn't it? So, number one for, hang on, number two for a dynamic circle. Oh, it is actually very, hang on. Let me just undo that. I'll just do a bit higher. Let's see. Okay, that's almost a good guess. Let me just do it there. I can always move it down afterwards. Let me do that. Otherwise, I'm not going to get this right. Like that. And you see how it's all the mirroring, how it's gone in like that? I know we did Mirror Me in the previous official webinar, but it is so good, isn't it? This one here. And this one here. I'm going to deactivate this mirroring again. Go back to Dynamic Sketch. I could use Pathfinder, obviously, for this bit, but yeah, I prefer to use a proper tool. Let's see. No, that's not nice. Pathfinder is a very good tool. Get rid of that one and then activate the mirroring again. Haha, that's suddenly gone. Why has that suddenly gone? Let's see. That's because I slated somebody else's tool, and that is what you call karma, folks. Let's have a look. Let's see what I've done with that one. I have deactivated it. Ah, have I got these things? Let's see. Ah, have I mucked around with the layers? Karma has struck. Karma has struck. Let me see if I just take these out. You see, Mirror Me does lock things as well. So let me take those ones out. I'm going to get rid of that. That. This one. That one. Let's get rid of all those extra ones. I flumped up the last bit. Let's make it active again. It still is. Get rid of that. That's an interesting one, to say the least. Let me get rid of that one. To be honest, I don't know. So I'm going to use my own method to get rid of this and get rid of those sections. I think the other section's interfering with it, actually. And activate it. There we go. I don't know. It was me being a numpty. Not a clue. So there we go. That wasn't the slickest end to that. That's because karma struck me with a vengeance. Let me select all these parts. Oh, I can remove the axes, and I'm going to, for some reason I've got the background as well. Let me activate, let me make that compound path, right click on it, shift X, fill stroke, there you go. So that wasn't very slick at the end, but there you go. That's how it went on this one. So hopefully you can see how I recreated those, and that was literally my best guess off the top of my head how I'd have done it. So Mirror Me was a good one. I could have done other methods and all that, but that struck me as being a rather good one. If I hide the guide and hide the background, they're pretty accurate symbols, I hope you think. Okay. Right, for those on the YouTube viewing platform, this will be the end of the webinar because I'm going to go into the Q&A session at the end, which is exclusive for those who are online. I'm also going to invite Dave and Carlos, who are fantastic colleagues, to help me out with the questions and answers here a bit as well. So please join us on a future webinar if you are looking on YouTube, and the link will be in the description of this video. So I hope you found some of those tips and tricks to be of use. Thank you very much.